Hey guys, welcome to this ASP video over mechanical calculations. There are several different equations that you want to be familiar with when heading in to take the ASP. In this video, we will review a few different terms within mechanical calculations and the equation each term is referencing. The 10 terms we'll be looking at are 1, statics, 2, vectors, 3, moments, 4, equilibrium equations, 5, cables, 6, pulleys, 7, distributed loads, 8, free body diagrams, 9, stress and strain, and 10, rigging. Let's take a look at statics. Newton's second law says that force is equal to mass times acceleration. When dealing with statics, the subset of mechanics that deals with rigid bodies in static equilibrium, the acceleration in Newton's equation is zero. This means that the sum of all forces applied to non-moving objects is also equal to zero. Now on to vectors. Vectors are quantities with both direction and magnitude. In two-dimensional space, vectors have horizontal x directions and vertical y direction components. Vector x and y components are calculated by multiplying the magnitude of the factor by its horizontal angle. So ax equals ax cosine theta and ay equals ax times sine theta, where ax is the horizontal component and ay is the vertical component. Theta is the angle between the positive direction on the horizontal axis and the vector, measured counterclockwise. To add vectors together, first sum the x components and the y components. Find the magnitude of the resultant vector by taking the square root of the sum of the components squared. So r equals square root of r sub x squared plus r sub y squared. Finally, determine the angle or the resultant vector by taking the inverse tangent of r sub y divided by r sub x. So theta equals inverse tan times r sub y divided by r sub x. Now, moments. Although a moment or a torque is the product of a particular force and distance, a moment can be either thought of as a rotational force or, more accurately, as a measure of how much a force will contribute to potential rotation. Moments may sound unnatural when described this way, but they are quite intuitive as a twisting force. The moment about a point is defined as the magnitude of the acting force multiplied by the distance between it and the line of action, given by the equation m equals f times d, where m is the moment, f is the force, and d is the distance perpendicular to the force to the point. Equilibrium equations. If an object is not moving, all the forces on it must be balanced. They are not necessarily equal, but the sum of all the forces acting on the object is zero. This knowledge can be used to calculate missing forces in static situations. For example, if a block rests on the floor without motion, it is at equilibrium. Because the object has some force due to gravity pulling it down, the floor must be opposing the block with an equal but opposite force. Two-dimensional force equilibrium says that the sum of all forces in the x and y direction is zero, and the sum of all moments is zero. So, from this information, we can derive the following equations. The summation of f sub x equals zero, the summation of f sub y plus zero, and the summation of m equals zero. Now, cables. An ideal cable has no mass, and tension is constant throughout the length. To determine the tension in cables, apply equilibrium equations. For example, in the following diagram, two cables support a weight of 456 pounds. To calculate the tension in each cable, write equilibrium equations for the system. The weight is not accelerating in the x direction, so the sum of the x components of the cable tension must be zero. So summation f sub x equals zero equals t sub 1x plus t sub 2x. Once again, there is zero acceleration, so the sum of the weight and the y components of the cable's tension must be zero. Summation f sub y equals zero equals t sub 1y plus t sub 2y minus w. The x and y components of the tension in both cables can be solved with trigonometry. T sub 1y equals T sub 1 times sine of 30. T sub 1x equals T sub 1 times cosine of 30. T sub 2y equals T sub 2 times sine of 45. T sub 2x equals T sub 2 times cosine of 45. Substituting these equations in for the original equilibrium equation results in T sub 1 cosine of 30 plus T sub 2 times cosine of 45 equals 0. Now, T1 and T2 can be calculated by solving for T1 in the first equation and substituting it in the second equation. To get T sub 1 equals T sub 2 times cosine of 45 over cosine of 30. Pulleys. A pulley is a wheel with a grooved rim around which a rope passes. It acts to change the direction of a force applied to the rope and is chiefly used for lifting heavy weights. An ideal pulley has no mass or friction. In a simple configuration with two equal masses suspended from a single pulley, the force on both rope segments is equal to F. Therefore, the force on the cable holding the pulley up must be 2 times F. More complex pulley systems can also be analyzed by applying the equation of static equilibrium. Distributed loads. Unlike a point load, a distributed load acts upon a length or area of an object. To calculate the effect of the distributed load, it must first be reduced to a resultant load that acts on one point of the length or surface. The magnitude of the resultant force is equal to the area under the curve of the distributed load. The location of the force is at the centroid, or weighted center, of the distributed load. The beam in this diagram has a rectangle-shaped distributed load on it. The magnitude of the resultant force can be calculated by solving for the area of the rectangle. We know that the area of a rectangle is A equals length times width. If you didn't already know that, then there you go. So when you plug in our numbers and cancel our units, we get area sub rectangle equals length times width equals 3 feet times 2 kip per foot equals 6 kips. The center of mass of this rectangle can be found by plugging the equation of the load into the following equation on the screen. Free body diagrams. Free body diagrams are essential to understanding the statics of rigid bodies. A correctly drawn diagram allows one to identify and calculate all of the unknown forces and moments acting on such a body. To begin drawing a free body diagram, separate the member of interest from the rest of the system at the joints or points of contact with other members. Draw a sketch of the member and include all applied forces and moments, as well as support reactions or joint forces. In this figure, a block rests on a ramp. Here, a free body diagram is drawn on the block, showing the three forces acting on it. Stress and strain. In mechanics, stress is a quantity of force per unit area in or on an object. Tensile or compressive stress acts normal to the area of the stress and is calculated with the following equation. Sigma equals F sub n over A, where sigma is the compressive or tensile stress, F sub n is the normal component force, and A is the area. For example, if the rod is half an inch in diameter and is hit by a sledgehammer bearing 100 pounds of force, the stress can be calculated as sigma sub rod equals 100 pounds divided by pi times 0.25 inches squared. Strain is the deformation of an object due to stress and is expressed by the following equation. Epsilon equals delta L over L sub 0, where E is the unitless measure of strain, delta L is the change in length, and L sub 0 is the initial length. Hooke's law states that stress and strain are directly proportional and equal to the modulus of elasticity. E equals sigma over epsilon, where E is the modulus of elasticity in PSI, sigma is the stress, and epsilon is the strain. Rigging. The most common types of slings used in rigging are wire, rope, chain, synthetic web, round, and metal mesh slings. The most common types of hitches are vertical, choker, basket, and 3 or 4-legged hitches. All slings come from the manufacturer stamped or labeled with a working load limit. This is not the breaking threshold of the equipment, but the maximum load the manufacturer has designed it to carry on a regular basis. When slings or sling legs of any kind are used at an angle other than vertical, the working load limit decreases accordingly. This reduction is called the sling angle factor. For basket and multi-leg slings, the sling angle factor is calculated by taking the sine of the angle between the load and the sling. Sling angle factor equals sine of angle between load and sling leg. To calculate the total working load limit for sling configurations, multiply the sling angle factor by the number of legs in the sling and by the vertical working load limit of one leg. Adjusted working load limit equals vertical working load times number of legs times sling angle factor. For example, consider a four-legged wire rope sling configured with 45-degree angles between the load and each leg. It's important to note that for chain slings, a four-legged sling's adjusted working load limit uses three legs in the equation. This is because of the difficulty in rigging a chain sling to distribute the load equally among four legs. Riggers often apply the same reduction to four-legged slings of any material for increased safety factor. If each leg of the sling has a vertical working load limit of 5,000 pounds, the reduced working load limit of the sling would be calculated as adjusted working load limit equals 5,000 pounds times three legs times sine of 45 degrees, which equals 10,606 pounds. It may be helpful to write down the equations we went over in this video and familiarize yourself with them. I hope that this review is helpful. For further study help, be sure to check out more of our videos by clicking right here. See you next time.